start framing up
the research that I do essentially revolves around this. So people tweeting, people posting things on Instagram, people reporting on what they do. So this is obviously the Holland, as we can see with the palm tree and everything. So this could easily happen in Rotterdam, you know, somebody taking a picture during the summer, during the past few weeks when the weather was nice. I myself was out there, so it could have been me technically taking this picture or taking this picture. I just, you know, crawled the Google search on pictures of people taking pictures, essentially with their smartphones. Here, this could be the stadium of Feyenoord or another club in Rotterdam. Or what we, of course, have a lot as well is what people call food porn. Yeah? So taking pictures of, you know, the nice food that you have here in the Phoenix Food Factory. So you have people essentially reporting on what they do, you know, in their daily lives, today, yesterday, during the summer, during their vacation, and posting this online, posting this essentially for the world to see as sort of into the public domain. And what we have done in the past, in a past research project, is basically analyzing these social media messages on a relatively large scale, and essentially just trying to see what we can find out by looking at these messages. But I figured since I'm giving this talk today in Rotterdam, I put in some extra work. So last Friday, I teach this in my undergrad bachelor course, yeah, so how to crawl tweets from Twitter. And I wanted to do it myself again after a long time, so I always just let the students do it and don't do it myself anymore. And then I realized, you know, all the packages are outdated and it doesn't work anymore. Twitter changed the entire API. So I thought this would be a really good thing to, you know, have a quick entry into the topic, and then it took me like 4 hours to prepare. But that's essentially just searching Twitter for messages from Rotterdam, like from really the area around Rotterdam. So that's what you can see. Is that? Yeah. What you can see here, the geocode, that is the longitude, latitude of Rotterdam, and sort of a 6-mile radius around it. Then you get a lot of data. You know, I asked for 1,000 tweets, n equal to 1,000. And you have to do a lot of pre-processing. So anybody who has worked with this kind of crowdsourced data, as we call it, knows that it usually involves a lot of pre-processing to get to a stage where you can actually work with it. So I did that. And in the end, I just looked at those tweets where I actually get a geo-coordinate with it. So it's only with a relatively small fraction of tweets, and just mapped it on the map of Rotterdam. When we look at that, it's essentially this. Yeah? So I guess most of you are familiar with this map, city center of Rotterdam, and you see these 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 dots. So these are tweets that were sent from the city center in Rotterdam last Friday in the afternoon at some point. Yeah? And I actually went through the steps of looking up those tweets then to actually, you know, see what the content is. The first one is somebody, you know, taking an Instagram picture of himself sitting on some bridge somewhere around the central station. Yeah? So just reporting, you know, this is what I do today. Yeah, I walk around the city, and when my feet tell me to stop, I just take a picture of myself and post it on Instagram. And something interesting, something that we, when we started this original research project on San Francisco, didn't have yet, is this, or didn't have to that degree, is really this linking between different social media sources. And so people used to post pictures directly on Twitter. They still do that to an extent, but you have a lot of these links to other social media sources where people actually post, you know, a picture of themselves sitting on a bridge. The other one is also, you know, a person, I don't know how well you can actually see it, you know, in the last rows, taking a selfie, being traveling, so you have all these travel tourist hashtags. So you can see already these are people that are in Rotterdam for tourist purposes, to phrase it that way, at least to a large extent. Here we have somebody at the Maritime Museum. Here we have somebody at the Schinhoek
if I pronounce that correctly, so it looks like some event down here. And this is the only one where I actually left the user identification in there. Up here we have the Freunden van Bleidorp, who apparently post very regularly things about the zoo. Yeah, so you can relatively easily link sort of the tweets that people post to the location where they post it and to the activities that they do where they post it. And in our research, again, we did not look at individual tweets, also to a certain extent for privacy ethics reasons, moral reasons, but we looked more at the sort of aggregate. What can we learn if we really analyze these tweets at a larger, on a larger scale? And what can we learn from looking at the content of these tweets on a sort of more analytical way? And what I want to go into in this talk, so what I want to reflect on in this talk, the urban activity and the things that social media data reveals at, that we can analyze by looking at, you know, these social media observations. So I want to focus on is again this research project that we did in 2014 to 2017. So 2 years ago, 600,000 geotech tweets from San Francisco between August and October 2013. So 600,000 in 3 months, so about 200,000 per month. This is San Francisco. I don't know, just, you know, a sign, who has been to San Francisco by any chance? So a couple of people who are not completely unfamiliar with this. So I guess most people are familiar with some of the sites, the tourist sites that we have in the city. So up here you have the Golden Gate and the Golden Gate Bridge. I think that a lot of people are familiar. In the city center, you have a lot of, you know, historic, well, not really historic in the European sense, but important for neighborhoods and things like this. So here you have a neighborhood that was very important for various social movements. Here you have Mission District, which is still sort of the hip area of the city, and so on and so forth. And essentially, we looked at the tweets and we analyzed the tweets to see whether from simple analysis we can identify these neighborhoods without necessarily knowing where they are in advance. For some, of course, we know where they are and where we can expect high activity, you know, of people posting about things, but of course you don't know, know it about everything. And especially when you have certain neighborhoods where you have events happening, so that are only interesting for a certain part of the year, then it's of course interesting to see, can I also sort of get this from the of the tweets. So the first thing that we did is this freaky heat map that you have here. Yeah, so it's basically just looking at all the tweets, all the 600,000 tweets, and posting or creating a heat map of those tweets. So essentially what we did is we transformed each individual tweet into sort of a bell shape, and then we put all these bell shapes on top of each other. And as a result, you get this sort of layered map. And you can see basically the darker it gets, the higher is the density of tweets in this particular area. So up here, this is the downtown area of San Francisco. So the contrast isn't that great on the projector, so let's go back. Here, downtown area, where you have the shopping streets and most of the tourists running around all the time, but of course also a lot of people just working. Working, going to breakfast, having a coffee, and of course in San Francisco a lot of people post, you know, pictures of their coffee and these kind of things. So it's no surprise that in the downtown area you have a high density of tweets, but you can also, you know, already see higher densities in some of the more touristy area. So up here at the waterfront, so you cannot really see it, but essentially the land area just goes to here. Yeah. So for the density to actually be relatively high, still a bit out into the sea, there need to be quite a few tweets being sent from there. And those are actually the views that you have on the Golden Gate Bridge and on Alcatraz, yeah, the famous prison island. So you have a lot of tourists up here, you have a lot of tourists down here. Here you have, it's actually wrong, the three. So the two is also the lens and lookout. The three back here is a former baseball arena. Yeah. So of course, events, you know, sport activity, you also have a lot of activity down here. But what you also have, and this is sort of the challenge, you know, how to distinguish different groups of people without actually, you know, invading their privacy to a certain extent, but without looking up their profiles and so on. Because down here, you also have sort of this hotspot of a lot of tweets, and that's just the university, yeah? San Francisco State University. So a lot of young people that use Twitter posting, you know, about how terrible exams are and these kind of things. So our next step was then to look at all the data that you get when you look at a tweet. Yeah? So when you crawl a tweet, what I did earlier, you get 85, 90 different columns of data for each tweet. Yeah? So a lot of different dimensions. The most important one is usually this one, text. Yeah? So what the people actually write. And maybe things like, you know, screen name, when it was created, and so on. But what we also have are things like media URL, URL, media type. So the question, do people attach anything? Yeah, do people attach pictures? Do people attach links to, for instance, Instagram? So to other pictures? And or do they not? And the reason why we want to find that out is simply that sort of our hypothesis is that, as we saw earlier, tourists or people doing sort of spare time activities are more likely to attach a picture. Yeah? If I want to impress all the people that are still at home, at work, and so on, of the great time I'm having in San Francisco or the great time I'm having in Rotterdam on vacation, I attach a picture and post it to Facebook or post it to Instagram or post it to Twitter or wherever. And so the basic idea is we want to look at these attachments and basically see whether we can identify more information from the densities that relate only to those pictures. We did here. So the first thing that we did is just the density of tweets with attachments. So you can see this is still the scale from earlier, so up to 10,000, more than 10,000. And we don't have this dark blue shade anymore. Yeah, so as we, if I go back to slides, we had a lot of that in the downtown area, and also this 1,000 or more area was much larger. If we look at the attachment with tweets, it's much less. Yeah, because people mostly just post, you know, status updates in a sense. Yeah, drinking a coffee without posting a picture of the coffee, because nobody really cares about the picture of the coffee. So if we just focus on the tweets with attachments, it becomes also, or it becomes evident that some of the areas with sort of a more tourist focus also become more relevant. Yeah. So the downtown area is still pretty relevant because we still have a lot of people down there, but this sort of Alcatraz view up here is now equally dense as the downtown area. Yeah, same thing back here, you know, the ocean and this sort of view on the Golden Gate Bridge from back here becomes relevant. The Golden Gate Park, so the big park in the city, becomes relevant. And you also have, as I mentioned before, these two neighborhoods, Castro and Mission, that you can see now in the density surface, simply because whenever people, or when you have people posting from these neighborhoods, it's very likely that they take, you know, pictures of these iconic billboards and things like that that they have there. Really interesting it gets, though, once we take one step further and look at what I call the conditional probability. So basically the question, if somebody sends a tweet, what is the likelihood of them attaching a picture? Yeah? Because the problem here is still that you just have so many tweets being sent from downtown that don't really, you know, have any, well, they do have meaning, but they are not focused on what we want to investigate, that they sort of drown out everything else around them. But if we look at the conditional probability, the question becomes, okay, you know, maybe people don't go there that often, but if they go there, what they see is so impressive, so nice, so touristy, that they definitely will attach a picture. And that is what we did in here. So the probabilities are still relatively low to that extent, because people might not just send one tweet or two tweets or three tweets from that location and only attach one picture to them. But we can really see these tourist hotspots then in comparison. Yeah? So we have the very high density here up here with the Alcatraz view. We have the very high density or the very high probabilities here with the view of the Golden Gate Bridge. We have a lot of tweets from, you know, Ocean Beach, from people, you know, surfing and so on. We even have, you know, relatively high densities up here in the middle of the sea. And those are essentially cruise ships or something like this that take a picture of San Francisco. And of course, if you tweet, okay, I'm approaching San Francisco, you have a relatively high likelihood to attach a picture of that. Down here, we also have another sort of old fort with guns and these kind of things that people like to take a look at. Here you have a performance stage, like a performance arena where you have a lot of events that you can see. And the only thing that we couldn't make sense of was this thing back here. Yeah, so we saw this and we couldn't really make sense of it, because I looked it up on Google and it was essentially this empty space of industrial port. Yeah, so very similar to what you have a few kilometers down the river here in Rotterdam, where you don't really expect people to send a lot of tweets of pictures from. Yeah, and I think they also had a homeless shelter there, and I found it a bit, you know, odd that people take pictures of homeless shelters. But then I looked up, okay, what happened in August to October 2013 in San Francisco and in that part of the city of San Francisco. And actually what during that time we had the America's Cup. There was this big sailing event, and Team Oracle was anchored back here. So there's nothing ever happening back there, but then this one time in the year, and coincidentally we, you know, had this time frame in our data, you have a lot of activity, you know, people taking pictures of the boat, essentially. And this is, if you look at this conditional probability, this is by far the highest one. Yeah, in this area. This is really the one, okay, if people go there, and I mean, there are obviously not a lot of people who go there because aside from the boat, there's nothing really there, but then they really take a picture and post it and say, I was there, basically. So this is some insights that you can get just from looking at the pictures, just from looking at the question, do people attach pictures to tweets? Do they not? Why do they do it, and so on. The second part of our analysis looks at what do people write about in their tweets. Yeah? And of course, as I said, we don't want to look at each tweet individually, because that just takes a lot of time for 600,000 tweets. So we applied a technique that is called LDA, latent Dirichlet allocation. I don't know who is familiar with that, but essentially assigns documents to topics, or rather topics to document. Yeah, so the assumption is that a document, so like a page of text, is a composition of different topics, and it tries to identify the topics automatically from the data. And because tweets are very short documents, yeah, just a few words, it's very hard to say, okay, one tweet is a composition of 5 or 10 different topics. So what we did here is, and that is why you have like all of these little boxes here, we collected tweets that happened in a certain part of the city in one box. And then we analyzed these boxes and tried to identify topics. The thing is, each topic, so the method doesn't tell you, you know, this is the topic that talks about the San Francisco Giants, the baseball team, I think. It just tells you this is the topic that is defined by these words. Yeah? and you have to check basically each topic whether you can find sort of words that define, that distinguish this particular topics from other topics in the data. And if you look at topic 8, I mean the first few words are park, AT&T. So we forgot to filter out the AMP. I don't know, those of you familiar with HTML know that the end AMP is the end sign. Yeah, so this is actually AT&T. San Francisco Giants, San Francisco Giants, like all of these words that really point to this one topic. And then if you map the likelihood of each topic being assigned to a certain cell, you actually get this map up here. Yeah. So of course, people all over the city talk about the San Francisco Giants when there's a game or something like this going on. But the people surrounding the stadium up here are definitely the ones talking most about it. Yeah, so you can assign individual topics directly to the locations just by this sort of aggregated, you know, method. So you don't have to look at individual tweets. You just aggregate all the tweets that you have and map them on the city. Another topic that was very clustered was the topic that we called VMworld. So VMworld is a big IT exhibition that happened during the time, and it happened essentially in this part of the city. Outside Lands is a big festival kind of things that happened in the Golden Gate Park. Well, it happened all over the city, so there were different stages in the city, but most activity was in the Golden Gate Park over here. And you can also find topics that relate again to these neighborhoods, Castro in this sense, in this case. And of course, it's not really surprising that in this particular case, it also falls on this particular area. Yeah, so essentially the message here is that we can use these messages to identify, well, tourist hotspots in a sense. Yeah, tourist hotspots, and also those that we might not be familiar with. Yeah, so if we would do it for Rotterdam or for a similar city, I mean, we probably know all of the areas where we expect, you know, people to take a lot of pictures, the Markthal, the Euromast, the bridge, and so on and so forth. But maybe, you know, by looking at, for instance, these conditional probabilities, we find spots where people don't go often, but if they go there, they really find it very, very beautiful. Yeah, and this is something that might not be as much, or people might not be as aware of otherwise. And also, by looking at the sort of textual analysis result, we can also identify the impact certain events have on what people talk about. Yeah, so as an analyst for the city or as an analyst for, you know, the people behind that event, you can actually see, okay, what kind of buzz does that particular event create. So to summarize, actually I have no idea. I think I'm doing okay time-wise. To summarize, research is that, well, social media does reveal urban activity to an extent and does reveal what is on people's mind. I mean, and of course, this is a subset of people. Yeah, I mean, the Twitter population is heavily biased towards, you know, young people, towards male people, and so on and so forth. But still, it is reflective of this part of the population. And so we can identify information for this part of the population. Built on this research project, or on this the paper that resulted from this old research project, I actually got a grant for a new research project, which was launched in July 2019. And we scaled a bit up as part of this research project. Yeah, in the San Francisco analysis, we analyzed 600,000 tweets over 3 months. In this new research project, we will analyze more than 100 million tweets over 7.5 years from London, Rotterdam, and Amsterdam. The main goal of that study is to really see whether we can use social media analysis to sort of observe changes in the city in real time, like social demographic changes and these kind of things. That's why, so the primary analysis will be on London, simply because it's a city with a lot of tweets. I mean, Rotterdam is good as well, but London is just bigger in that sense. And it is a city that changes a lot, yeah? Where every day, more or less, a new skyscraper is built somewhere. And during this observation period, we also had the 2012 Olympics. So we want to analyze whether sort of these patterns, you know, of gentrification, of urban decay, to some extent can be observed in the social media activity and can also be predicted in the social media or through the social media activity. I would really have loved to show you some of the data or some of the, you know, early visuals of this data today. I cannot, because it's really, really hard to buy data from Twitter. I started the purchasing process in May. I'm still not done. And it's us who give money to them, so it's tricky. But maybe for the data brigade next year or in 2 years, we will be able to show you some results. What we will do, though, is so we have a lot of master students in our programs, business information management at RSM, and I will let them explore the Dutch data sets in particular. So if you, you know, have some ideas of things that we could investigate that might interest you related to this data, you know, just tell me for this project in particular. But I'm also part of the Knowledge Lab Urban Big Data, along with some people from the municipality, some people from the Hogeschool, and we collaborate with the municipality on questions surrounding urban big data that go beyond, you know, the context of this project. So in general, if you have topics related to urban big data that you would like a master student to explore, you can contact me, but I will just forward you to this person, Hadi Hisala, and he will arrange everything. And with that, I don't know who is still familiar with this movie, and it's not really easy to see on this projector. It's a scene from The Lord of the Rings, with the questions that need answering. Yeah. So are there questions that need answering? Or is everybody too bossed by this? Yes, so Twitter provides 90 different attributes. When you crawl it from like the tweet stream, they give you 90 different attributes. I mean, most attributes are kind of not very interesting, and there are also a lot of duplicates. I mean, we can go back to that. Oh wait, that was right. There. Because you get, oh god. You get the user ID, you get the status ID, so the ID of the tweet, you get the date, you get the screen name, and of course you have a lot of redundancy. I mean, you can also get the screen name. If you have the status ID, technically you can get everything. And then you have, you know, everything this tweet is connected to. So if this tweet is a response to another tweet, then you actually also get any text from the other tweet that is quoted, any information about this other tweet that is quoted from, and so on and so forth. You get a lot of information about the user, so things that relate to the user ID, things like statuses count, favorites count, and so on and so forth, account created at. So you just get everything. They just throw everything at you, essentially. I still have the between those two, so geo-coords and cohorts, both just give you the coordinates, like latitude, longitude, but to me, they look exactly the same. So that's why I said there's a lot of redundancy in there, but of course, a lot of information that you can find there. Yes, yeah. So this is an R, but you have packages for pretty much every, let's say, common language, well, Python. So Python and R, it's very easy to get connected to the API. And if you, I mean, there's a free version free version of the API that just gives you a snapshot, essentially, of the tweets. So it's neither representative of all the tweets that were sent, nor like time-wise really accurate, and so on. That's why for these sort of really large-scale analyses, we resorted to actually buying the tweets, because to crawl 100 million tweets, you need like a couple of years otherwise, and that's time we don't have. Yeah.
Could you repeat the question, please?
Okay. So the question was, why did we analyze Twitter too? Okay. So the thing is, Facebook is harder to get data because the purpose of Facebook is not really to be a public, you know, way for people to just share whatever they think. Yeah, it's more sort of a private thing in that sense. So. In Twitter, I mean, I think technically you can make Twitter posts private, but nobody really does that. So when you post something on Twitter, it's for everybody there to see. You can delete it later on. So it's more representative in that sense. The thing with things like TripAdvisor and so on, they are always linked to specific places, right? And it's a different kind of analysis in that sense. But also something that we want to look at also in connection to this new project is basically linking different social media channels, because we are actually interested in how well are they aligned, or maybe one contributes something that the other doesn't contribute, and so on and so forth.
One last question, looking at the time.
But you can ask and I repeat.
Could it be interesting to link this Twitter data to other type of data sources and think about other use cases? For instance, Twitter data linked to social data of people, air quality data. So how are people perceiving living in the city, and do they tweet about it?
So I don't know about air quality data. Something we could look at, whether people tweet about not being able to breathe or something like this, or it's a nice day, I can finally, you know, don't have tanker air coming in. What we did try is actually linking tweets to crime data, so sort of trying to improve crime prediction through tweets, not because we think that people tweet when they commit a crime, but rather because, so these tweets are usually sent from you know, areas where you have events and these kind of things, where you have gatherings of people. And you have certain, you know, types of crimes that are simply more frequent in these type of situations. Yeah, things like theft, things like assault. So you find a lot of assaults more around bars and these kind of establishments. We did try that, and it does improve sort of your prediction performance compared to just looking at historical crime data. But as soon as you also include data like points of interest, so as soon as you include data on where bars are, you get even better results. Yeah, so it does provide something, but in that sense, it just proxies for something else. So the contribution that Twitter or social media data brings, it's just the information, okay, there's a bar there, so there's probably a higher likelihood of assaults at this time of the day or something like this. Or a higher likelihood of people drunk bicycling or something like this. Yeah? But it's something we are looking into.
Okay, so I think we're going to round up. Thank you very much.
Thank you.